for you, okay? So which three should we do? 5, 7, 8.
I agree.
I agree.
Five. There's this wooden box. Let's see if I can find this thing I made a while back. So we're talking about the volume and the area of this thing, okay? Someone remind us all what area is. Not how to find area, but what area is. Bridger?
It's the amount of squares that's in the inside of the object.
When you hear about area out in the world, it's exactly what they're saying. That many squares fit. It just depends on which squares we're talking about, whether it be feet squares or inch squares or centimeter squares or mile squares or whatever, okay? So the number of squares that can fit, that is what area is. Okay. Now, if the number of squares that can fit is the area, then what would volume be? What do you think? Cube. Cube, it's a square in the extended into a third dimension, right? The square on all sides are exactly the same as each other. So a cube, the number of cubes that can fit is what we would call the volume, okay? So, this guy works. Slide that cube in there. We know that this has a volume of at least what?
One cube.
Right, and I could just keep sliding these cubes in there until I filled it up with cubes. And then once I count up all the cubes, then I'll know the volume. The volume is how many cubes fit. So let's talk about the volume of, the volume of a box, of any box. Let's make it simple. We'll go ahead and give this box specific dimensions. Let's say that it measures 7 this way and 9 that way, and it's, let's say, 3. I've already decided 3, sorry. Let's go ahead and fill in these edges that we can't see.
How did you get 9?
Just made it up. Alright. So first, let's talk about some area, and then area is going to be a simple extension into volume. Okay? We put our books away. Let's talk about the area of the bottom part that like we can't really see. We have to come look through the box to see it. Can you tell me some of the area of this bottom part here? Yes. So somebody said 63. Does 63 sound right?
7 times 9 is 63.
7 times 9. You can fit 7 squares this way, right? If I put square right along there. Since this measures 9, there's enough room for 9 of them this direction. And so right there, let's say. What do we have right there?
One cube.
Is that a cube I just drew?
Uh,
90 degrees.
It's a not very good looking square. Maybe if I erase this scribbly part, you can see what I was trying to do is draw a square that's laying down. Okay. What about over here? What do we have?
Square.
All right. Now, I know that how many squares can fit along the bottom?
63.
63 can fit along the bottom. There's 63 squares. Now, let's take a look at this one square and use it as an example for all other squares. Well, this measurement is 3. So if I go up in this direction, I can fit a square there, right? If I go along the front face here, I can put a square on the front part, right?
Mm-hmm.
A square there, and a square there. And what have we made?
A cube.
A cube.
How do we square?
Okay. There's enough room for a cube? I'm asking, is there enough room for a cube to sit there? Yes.
3 up.
Is there enough for another cube to stack on top of that one?
Yes.
And another on top of that?
Yes.
And another on top of that?
No.
There's not enough room for that. How do I know there's not enough room?
Because it's 3.
This is 3. If I drew 4 there, you should call me on it and say, no, that's not, you can't do that, because it only says it's 3 tall. So, we can stack 3 cubes up tall, right?
Mm-hmm.
We just did that all on top of this one square, right?
Right.
How many squares are there along the bottom?
1.
63.
63 squares. And on top of every square, since it's 3 tall, how many cubes can I stack up on every square?
3.
3. So how many cubes are there?
63 times 3.
For every square that's along the bottom, there's 3 cubes that can fit. Right? So there's 63 times 3 cubes that can fit inside of this box. Did we need to be told the formula and memorize it?
No. We figured it out.
We just needed to know what volume was, right? And I forget who said volume is the number of cubes. Area is the number of squares, volume is the number of cubes. Okay.
Aiden.
Figure it out. 7 times 9 gives us the area. Times 3 then tells us, like, well, we have 62 squares along the bottom. Times 3 would tell us how many layers of that many cubes.
Would
it be 189? Would it be 189? I don't know. But, 63 times 3. Yes. 189 cubes can fit inside of that guy.
Figure that out.
So let's come back to this. This box is X along that side. It is 5 tall, and it is 6 wide. I can put the 6 there or there. The picture has it back there. But it's all the same thing. So I think it would be easiest to start with the volume. How many squares could fit along the bottom of this?
6.
6X squares could fit, right? And on every square that's down here, all 6x of them, how many can we stack on top of each of those squares? 5. So how many cubes? How many cubes fit inside of this thing?
It's 63x.
No,
it's not 63.
Oh, 63 is not in this equation.
Oh, I see. How many cubes can fit?
5. Oh,
30.
30x. So 6x squares fit along the bottom.
Mm-hmm.
There's enough room, so like, let's use this as an example square right there. There's enough room to stack 5 cubes, right? Because it's 5 tall.
Right.
So 5 cubes can sit on every one of these squares. There's 6x squares. So 6x times 5, that's how many cubes can fit. Let's look at it a different way. What's the area of this space right here? How many squares fit in this space? 30, right? 30-ish, kind of. Is it all right?
Beans. Oh, it went out the door. Okay, we did.
All right, 30 squares fit here. All right? So now, this time, we're not stacking the cubes up. We're... extending them out in this direction, or kind of laying them down. How many cubes can I fit on this square right here?
5.
Along this way.
5
x.
X
of them, yes. I can, on this one square, one of how many that fit here?
30.
One square, I can line up how many cubes along this way?
X.
X of them. I don't know how many X is, but whatever X is, I can put X of them there. Right? So there's a row of X cubes, right? How many rows of those X cubes are there?
5.
Well, there's one
6.
For every square, right?
1, 2, 5, 6
along this way. Well, there's 6 this way, and then there's 5 that are stacked up, so there's 30 of those. Right? Same as 6 times X times 5, they all come out to be 30 times X. However you look at it. So this kind of shape, this box shape, if I just find the area of this one side, of any side, the top, the bottom, this side, and then I multiply it by the third dimension. That third dimension is measuring how many cubes I can stack up or lay down. So 5 times 6 times x, or 30x, is the volume of this thing. And then we are supposed to find the surface area. Surface area of the whole thing is 30?
The whole
30
thing,
is the surface area of what?
Of one side.
Which side?
The one closest.
Front side. The front side. Is it also the area of another side?
Yes, the other.
The other, across side. The way, right? The back side is also 30. Okay. So we have
then there's 5x.
30 times 2. Right? So that's like 1/3 of the area so far, kind of. I mean, it's 2 of the 6 faces. There's 6 faces to add up. So we have this side and that side are the same. What's the area of this side?
6x.
5 this way and x this way. So 5 times x squares would fit there. So we would add on 5x. Just 5x? There's 2 of them, so 5x times 2. Plus, okay, we found the area of this and there's 2 of those. The area of this side and there's 2 of those. So the area of this, the top and the bottom. What's the area of the top?
6x.
Times 2, because there's 2. Remember formulas? Figure it out. 60 plus 10x plus 12x. Clean it up some more. 60 plus 22x. How's that straight? Does that make sense?
I got that. I had that put up there. But I think I did something wrong in between there. Like, I remember doing it on the paper and I got the answer, but I don't know what I did after that because I don't have it.
Okay, well, the problem then states that the volume, the value of the volume, and the value of the area are equal to each other. Okay. As we discussed before, these two things can't actually be equal to each other. Why can't the volume of a box and the area, the surface area of a box, be the same thing? Exactly the same thing. Richard?
The surface is just the top layer and the volume is the full, like all of it.
Almost.
No, I have a question. I'm so really confused.
That's not a question.
Where did you get 6x?
Where is it? Somebody want to say where we got 6x? Kyler?
That is 6x from what's on top.
What's on top? What do you mean by what's on top? What about the, okay, the area of the top,
yeah?
This side here is 6, so I can fit 6 along here. This side here is x, right? So 6 times x would tell me how many squares can fit on top. That would also tell me how many squares can fit on the bottom, because the bottom is identical to the top. So that's where we get 6x, that's the area of the top, times 2, because there's 2 faces that are identical, that both would have an area of 6x.
Please. Why isn't 5x on top times 2? Because you have 2 sides.
This is times 2.
Oh, I don't see.
Yeah, it doesn't look like a very good 2.
Okay.
Times 2. That's where we got the 10x.
Okay.
Bridger.
For where you have the 30 plus 2 plus 5x, could we just right there already calculate what 5x times 2 is and make it 10x plus 12x?
That's what I have here.
I mean, but can we skip that step?
I'll go right from here to there.
Yeah.
Sure, if you don't. If you're not prone to making mistakes in that much of a jump, then, like, the more we do these kinds of things, the more we learn about algebra, the more practice we get, the more things we cut out, right? The more steps we don't write down But that really should be done when we don't make mistakes in that step anymore, right? And that leap is natural for us to make. So as long as you don't make mistakes, if you are trying it out and you're doing fine and you can put 10x in your head and 12x in your head and put them together and get 22x, then just go right for it. So that's where 6x comes from. 5x similarly comes from 5 this dimension, x along this dimension. So whatever 5 times x is, that's how many squares would fit on this face. There's 2 of those identical faces, 5x times 2. 60 plus 22x. So my question a minute ago was, why can't the perimeter, the area and the volume actually be equal to each other? Be exactly equivalent to each other?
They're two different things.
What two different things are they? The area is a what?
Is just multiplying.
Now how to find it? What is it?
Squares.
Squares. And what's the volume?
Cubes.
Cubes. Cubes and squares. Can a square be a cube?
No.
No. So a square cannot be a cube. So the area and the volume can't be equal to each other, but their numbers could be the same. Right? And that's what it's saying. The numbers for the volume and the area are the same. So that, if I knew what x was, that's how I would find the number for the volume. If I knew what x was, this is how I would find the number for the area. So the number for the area, the volume, is equal to the number for the area. That we get for the volume is equal to the number that we get for the area. They're equal to each other. Now we have this equation that is this new kind of equation. What's new about this equation? It's different from other equations we've done before the day we learned about this.
There are two variables.
There's variables on both sides of the equation.
Yeah.
Right, yes, that's true. Now, what are we going to do about it? How are we going to solve 4x? Chris.
Subtract 22x.
I love that idea. Subtract 22x, first of all. What happens on the right side of the equation when I subtract 22x?
You have to use it on the right
side. Cancel it out.
But yeah, the 22x and 22x cancel each other out. We're left with 60 on this side. Of course, we have to do the same thing on both sides. And 30x minus 22x is what?
8x.
Perfect. That's a great idea. We took the x's off of the side that was with a number, left the number by itself. Now the variable by itself. And how do we figure out what x is? Mom.
You divide 8.
Divide by 8. 60 divided by 8.
It's
0.5. 7.5, if you do it yourself, 60 divided by 8, you'll find a 7.5. 7 times 8 plus 6 plus 4 more, which is half of 8, that's the 0.5, and that makes it 60, 7.5. And that was the question, that's the answer to the question. The question was, what is x? How long is that side? 7.5 inches. If we were to plug 7.5 into both of those, we would find the volume and the area both have the same number. Yeah.
Wouldn't it be cubed?
No. Look at what x is. X is this side. How would we measure a side of the of this box? We measure an area. Squares.
Cubes.
The side of this thing. We measure it in cubes. Squares. Measure in squares.
Yep.
Yeah.
If I walk from here to here. Would I measure how far I walked in squares?
No.
Inches.
Just lines, like inches, right? Just straight inches, not inches squared. I don't need a square to measure how far I went, right? So along this side here, we would measure that in just inches. We would get out a ruler, we would measure in one direction, one dimension, and just measure inches. Inches squared would be the area, inches cubed would be the volume. If we were to plug this into this guy right here, 30 times 7.5, we would get a number, and that number would be the number of what that fit inside this thing?
Cube.
So it would be cubic inches. Inches that are cubes. Cubes that are an inch on every side. That's what we mean by inch cubed. So x itself is inches, and if I plug it in here, I'll find area, which would be how many squares, so that'd be square inches. If I plug it in here, that'd be finding out how many cubes fit, cubic inches. And if you think about it, what is six? Six what? Six what? Six cubes? How would I measure the length of this side? What would I use?
Cubes.
Clint, the number stands. 6
what?
Inches. 6 inches, right? You get a ruler, you measure it in one dimension. You don't need squares, you don't need cubes to measure the length of a side. It's just inches. So I have 6 inches. Volume equals 6 inches times 5 what?
Times 5 inches.
Times, now we know this is 7.5. 7.5 what?
Inches.
Now 6 times 5 times 7.5. Someone rattle that out for me. We've got a calculator. 80? 6 times 5 times
7.5?
30. 225. 225. Okay, because 6 times 5 times 7.5 is 225. Now what's an inch times an inch times an inch?
1 inch.
Inch cubed.
Inch cubed. An inch times an inch times an inch is an inch times itself 3 times, or an inch cubed. Okay, the next one we wanted to do was 7? Not that yet. 7. Is 1 equals 7. Okay. Minus 2. Positive. Alright, so we have an equation here that's very much like the equation we just saw. It has variables on both sides. If we have variables on both sides, we'll never figure out. Scale is an analogy for this equation, which it is. If we have variables on both sides, then we never know what that variable is worth. And we'd just be comparing variables to variables, containers to containers. How much does a container weigh? I'll never know unless I have containers on this side and weights or just numbers on the other side. So how do I, on one side, cancel out the variable parts?
Divide.
Minus 3k
on both
sides.
Plus 3k.
Let's see what happens when we do minus 3k. What's 3k minus 3k?
Zero.
You start at 3k, you go back 3k, you're back at 0. Okay? Is that a good thing for us?
Yeah,
we like to have not k's on both sides. K's only on one side is what we want. And we have to do the same thing on both sides, so this is just whatever it's going to be. This side is negative 1 plus nothing else. 4k is what we get, plus 2. And that's our good friend, the two-step equation. We subtract 2 from both sides. Negative 3 equals 4k.
5
by 7.
4.
5 by 4. K is equal to negative 3. We're not afraid of fractions, so we can just leave it as a fraction. Maybe. Number 8. Negative 2x plus 10. Equals, I think it's equals, that's negative 2 times the parentheses, x plus 5. What do you think we should do first? What's something we could do here, Sarah?
The distributive property.
Okay. Tell me what I would get over here when you do the distributive property, Sarah.
Negative 2x and then plus
10.
Negative
2. You got negative 2, right, times 5.
Or minus 10.
Negative 10. So negative 2x minus 10. Over here we have negative 2x plus 10. All right. Now again, we have variables on both sides. So, Ethan?
You would add 2x to each side.
All right, that would cancel out this 2x, and that'd be great. So we'll do that to both sides. Negative 2x plus 2x is what?
2.
So on this side, we have 10. Negative 2x plus 2x is what?
0.
0. Well, this side is just 10. This side is negative 10. Is this true?
It is not true.
If it's not true, what is it?
False.
False, right. The opposite of true is false. So we have a false equation, a false statement.
Mm-hmm.
It's saying negative 10, plus I guess it's saying 10 is negative 10.
It's not that.
It never will be. I don't know, maybe some weird universe it could be, but 10 is not going to be equal to negative 10. It's impossible. 10 is equal to 10. Negative 10 is equal to negative 10. And that's the way it always will be.
Mm-hmm.
So, what happened there? I mean, what's going on? Yeah? So that, are you saying that this and this are the same? Of course, they're identical. Because whatever x is the same here and here. So negative 2 times that number is going to be the exact same as negative 2 times that number. Those two things are exactly the same. So how could it be that I plug 5 in there, right? That'd be, if I was plugging 7 in there, 7. So negative 14 and negative 14, right? Could negative 14 plus 10 be the same as negative 14 minus 10?
No.
So they like have the same number on one side, we're adding 10, on the other side we're subtracting 10. There is no number that we can plug in for x that would make that work. You see what I'm saying?
I see what you're saying.
And the number that we plug in for x is the thing that we call the solution.
Mm-hmm.
Is there any number that we can plug in for x that will work?
No.
So the name that we give that number that we plug in for x that makes it work is the solution. And since that can't be, since that doesn't work, since there isn't any x that works, we have no
solution. So it's false.
If we get a false statement, there is no x that will work.
Yeah.
So there is no solution.
Mm-hmm.
The number that works for x is what we call the solution. There is no number that works for x, so there is no solution. So, to solve an equation with variables on both sides, we want to cancel out the variables on one side. I don't like to say moving to the other side, because that's not what's happening. We're just taking them away from both sides, or adding them to both sides. Okay? And on one of the sides, that thing that we did, hopefully we'll just cancel out one of those variables here in number 7. When we subtracted 3k, it canceled out this 3k, and so we're left with just variables on one side of the equation. Did I move 3k over here?
No,
I didn't do any moving. If I had a scale and I moved stuff from this side to that side, it'd be all kinds of messed up.
Right.
I don't like to use bad terminology, so I won't. We're not moving it, we're just canceling some out on this side, so that like hopefully we cancel out all of the variables on one side. The other side is whatever happens, it's just what it is, and we move on from there. Is there something else I could do down to this equation besides subtract 3x, or sorry, 3k? Is there a different first move I could have made?
Plus.
That one I would be very hesitant to divide at the beginning. Grace?
Plus 1.
You could have added 1. And so if I add 1 to both sides, I would add 1, negative 1 plus 1 is 0, so I get 3k plus nothing equals 7k. Now I need to add 1 to this side, 2 plus 1 is 3. That's what it looks. A little bit closer to something that is solvable. What would you do then? Minus 3k. What's 3k minus 3k?
0.
Get 0 on this side, and on this side I get
4k plus
3. 4k plus 3. I don't know about that. I mean, it's certainly true. But if I did this other thing, let me just suggest this idea. And the reason I'm going to suggest it is just going to have, I think have fewer steps. Okay. What if I subtract 7k? What's 7k minus 7k?
0.
What's on this side now?
3.
Just a 3. And if I subtract 7k, what's 3k minus 7k?
Negative
4k. So negative 4k equals 3, and all that's left is to divide by negative 4.
0.75.
It's probably just one step faster than if you were to subtract 3k from both sides, because then you have 4k plus 3, and then you're going to have to minus 3 from both sides, you're just kind of doubling your work there. Where if you cancel out the k's on one side and then do the same thing to the other side, you'll have variables on one side, numbers on the other side. Okay, does that make more sense than it did when you walked in?
Yes, a lot more sense.
Good. Let's pass in the homework. All right, so missed an opportunity there. Pushing our work onto Friday rather than doing something hard. So, all right, we've got 5x plus 6 equals 8x minus 9, and what should we do? Subtract 5x, of course, we've got both sides. 5x minus 5x is nothing, leaving 6. 8x minus 5x is 3x minus 9. And Ethan?
Has 9 to both sides.
9 to both sides. Good. 15. Give you 3x. Now save the suspense. We divide by 3.
Yay.
That's right. Okay. What do you think we should do first in this equation? Everybody. Sarah.
Distributive property.
Distributive property. 3x minus 21. We're good there. Negative there. Distribute it to 7. Alright, next. Grace.
Minus 4x on both sides.
Sounds good to me. 4x minus 3x. 3 equals 3x minus 4x.
Negative
1x. Negative 1x. Alright, next.
Add 21 to both sides.
Add 21 to both sides. 4 negative x equals 24. Almost there, but we don't want to know what x or negative x is. We know what x is. Molly?
Since 24 equals negative x, then x would equal
24. Good, that's true. Is there a mathematical operation I can do to both sides to make that happen? Ian? Divide by negative 1. That'll do it. How about multiply by negative 1? No? What would be negative 1 times 24?
24.
Negative 24. What would be negative x times negative 1?
One.
Positive 1x, yeah. So it would be the same. Molly?
I got negative 24,
yeah.
But afterwards, when I was checking my answer and plugging in
happens a lot, someone will ask a question and they'll say, oh. Well, time that you have left for us. Let's take out this sheet.
Alright, pass that in.
Now this figure is the same as the first four. The first four are just rectangles. This is multiple rectangles. Okay. So the area of this whole figure is going to be seen as the area of two rectangles. This rectangle and this rectangle. If I knew the area of this rectangle, what would I do with them so I know the area of all of it? So what is the area of this guy here?
Two
times one. Two squares will fit right there. Two. Plus the area of this. What's the area of this bigger thing?
3x.
3x. 2 plus 3x. Now the perimeter. The perimeter is just the measure all the way around. Not through the middle, just all the way around the outside. Okay, so let's start here. Right? So 2. How long is this?
1.
We add a 1, and how long is this?
What?
Right here.
1.
How do you know it's 1?
Because this is 3 on that side.
This is 3, this is 2, so this must be 1. So plus another 1. Plus, how long is this side?
X.
Plus what next?
3
plus.
3
plus X plus another 1. That's the distance all the way around. Right. We've gone all the way around and measured all the sides and added all the sides up.
I passed that worksheet in my
other one. So, if it's still back there, then you should grab it. Unless you're done. You're done. Alright, so we add them all up and we get the perimeter is equal to 2, 3, 4, 7, 8 plus 2x. 2 plus 3x is the area, that's equal to the number we have for the perimeter, which is given by 8 plus 2x, subtract 2x on both sides, 2 plus x equals 8, subtract 2 on both sides, and x is 6.
Hey, wait, do you have any food? No.
The other two are just like that. Your homework here is these two, the 13 and 15, basically, like, you're just given equations to solve, you solve them, the rest of them, you're going to have to read it and interpret what kind of equations you write. Have a good day.
It's not back there.